Yeah, my name is Matthew Bunson. I'm EWTN senior contributor and also a senior editor with the National Catholic Register. Well, my mother grew up in Chicago, the south side of Chicago, South Shore specifically. And she grew up in a determinedly Episcopalian household. On her mom's side, they came from Scotland and England. On her dad's side, from Sweden. So she grew up in a very clear Protestant environment. And I think it's safe to say that she also grew up, without making any sort of accusation against anyone, in a pretty hostile anti-Catholic atmosphere. So her conversion, I think, came as a surprise to her as much as anyone else. My mother's conversion began in a snowstorm. Not exactly the road to Damascus, I know, but she was on Michigan Avenue in Chicago in the deep of winter, in the midst of a heavy snowfall, so she could not actually see the ground. She was trudging through the snow and kicked something, and it went flying, and she was curious as to what she had kicked. So she searched for it in the snow, dusted it off, and sure enough, it was a book. And she stuffed the book in her cloak and just kept walking. And she went to a nearby pharmacist. Now, back in those days, the pharmacies, drugstores, used to have a soda counter, a soda fountain. And so she sat down, and over a cup of hot chocolate that was always given to her for free by the Jewish pharmacist who liked her, that she would talk to all the time, she opened the book and discovered it was the Baltimore Catechism. And she began reading it and grew instantly intrigued. She always talked about the fact that those opening questions, you know, why did God make me? Who is God? Intrigued her so much that she just kept going and devoured the entire book in the afternoon. And then, over the course of the next few days, odd things began happening, that people would give her books out of the blue, all Catholic, including that Jewish pharmacist who told her, she was sitting at the counter, that I think someone left this behind, he said, but something tells me, because he was looking very carefully but very courteously at what she was reading, he said, I think you're supposed to have this, and it was the breviary. Now, she recognized immediately that bringing back Catholic literature into her home was not the ideal situation for her, so she hid the books from her parents and gradually assembled, using book covers from her school books, everything she could find to hide these, her own small little Catholic library that she then spent the next months scouring, studying, perusing. But at the same time, she was being introduced to Catholic prayer life. And the prayers of the church, especially the breviary, touched her heart very profoundly. She geared up for the day when she was going to tell her parents that she was coming into the church. She waited very wisely until her 18th birthday in 1948 and broke the news to them. And they did not react particularly well. But she recognized, too, that this was her first great opportunity to witness the Catholic faith in a hostile environment. It began not just a lifelong journey, but it was one of intense personal study, because she went from Chicago to Indianapolis, spent some time with the Carmelites there, discerned briefly a vocation of the religious life, and then studied at Mary Grove, I think just outside of Detroit. And it was there that she was introduced to the full intellectual tradition of the church. Fell in love with Thomas Aquinas, Augustine. She fell in love with Catholic literature and studied for first a BA and then an MA. And soon after, spent time in Puerto Rico where she worked for the church. Spent time then also in New Orleans and San Antonio. And it was in San Antonio that she met my father, Sidney Bunson, who was an army officer. And she always said that she was not the most social person. She preferred books to parties. But she was convinced by her friends to go to an officer's party at San Antonio in Fort Sam Houston in Texas. And looked across the room when she walked in and saw a rather dashing officer. And she always said that it was as though somebody whispered in her ear, as clearly as I'm speaking right now, you will marry that man. And so they got to know each other, and sure enough, a year later, this is in 1960, a year later, they were married. Now, I mention all of this because my father was also a convert. My dad was Jewish by upbringing, and entered the military right after Pearl Harbor, and studied, was sent to officer candidate school, even though he was only a high school graduate, and went on to what I think everyone would agree was a pretty brilliant career. Went in as a private and came out a colonel, lieutenant colonel specifically. In the military, throughout World War II, he began having encounters, conversations with Catholic chaplains. And he always told me that among his fellow soldiers, that if you had a problem, don't go to the Protestants, don't go to anybody. And they said they're fine, but if you have a really serious issue, go to the Catholic chaplains. And that was his own experience throughout the war. Now, I mention that also because my dad was with the U.S. Army Medical Service Corps. So he picked up the wounded and the soldiers who were literally bleeding to death in the field. And he was also one of the very first medical troops into the Dachau concentration camp. Now, let's remember that this was right after it had been liberated. So they were the frontline troops for dealing with the unimaginable conditions of the camps. And my dad said that being Jewish himself, this had a very profound impact on him. But the counsel, the spiritual advice, and the guidance that he received from the chaplains was instrumental in him surviving emotionally and spiritually an encounter with absolute pure evil. And so after the war, in 1948, he converted. Now that's a date that is significant to my mom because while my father was converting in 1948, so was my mother. So both of them came into the church in 1948, but did not meet until 1960. And they had both been Catholics then for about 12 years when they met. And both, I think, were very mature in the faith at that point. They talk often about the zeal of Catholic converts, of converts to the faith, from a variety of denominations, and in my dad's case, from Judaism. That there is this zeal that you grow up with if you have the good fortune of being their children. There is the phrase of cradle Catholics who, unfortunately, as we have seen in the years after the Second Vatican Council and sort of the modern era, cradle Catholics sometimes leave something to be desired in their catechesis, in their own formation. What I found growing up was that because my father was ill with Huntington's disease, that I was able to see, in his case, how his Catholic faith gave him the fortitude, the powerful virtue of fortitude, and prudence and temperance and even justice in dealing with what was a debilitating disease that had no cure and that would eventually take his life in 1984. And so I had the lesson of how to live your life how to die with grace from my father, while my mom demonstrated the similar virtues, especially fortitude, but also the powerful virtue of charity, of hope, and of course, of all of those virtues coming together to play a part in how she dealt with my father's disease, how she raised two children, myself and my brother. But then also, she worked for the church in Hawaii. So I had the privilege of literally growing up in a chancery. And I was surrounded then by priests, by bishops. Fulton J. Sheen came to Hawaii, for example. I had the privilege of actually serving him dinner in our house. And I mention that because for my mom, all of this seemed very regular. She had worked in chanceries since the time of her conversion, so she was very comfortable with ecclesiastical life. So it made me very comfortable with being around clerics, but also studying the faith. I was blessed, as I said, by growing up in a chancery office that was just filled, stuffed with books, with materials that would come in, but also having those conversations as a child with my mother's friends who came from all over the world to visit Hawaii, to visit her. And so I had that intellectual formation to the degree that it rubbed off on me, but I also had then the formation in love, in what it meant to love. And my mom's capacity for love was something that it was truly, truly remarkable to watch even as a child. So it's not enough simply to study the faith, to know the church's teachings, to know theology. Unless you live it, it's dry. you have to make it your life. And I think that was probably the greatest lesson that both my parents imparted to me.